Hello everyone, hope you are doing well. So this is a new video today about Azure Data Factory and Logic Apps for Dynamics 365. Finance operation again. But you will see that this kind of video can be also part of Dynamics 365, the whole ecosystem of business application. Just a little quick promotion, because I don't know if you have seen, but I'm part of the main organization of the Power Platform French Summit. So if you are French, but also we have some English session, especially also some keynote from US. It's in like end of November, in few weeks now, and I will put the link again directly below of this video. So feel free to register. We are already at 400, I think, registration so far. So it's a massive event in France. So end of promotion. So today I've created a new blog post. I think of course I will put also this link of this new post, blog post article. But for me, this one, maybe you have seen that I write quite a long post eventually often. So now I think, for this kind of topic, I prefer to present just very quickly, in this video, how it works, Azure Data Factory integration services of Azure with Dynamics 365 Finance Operation. Because I've seen a lot of projects. In fact, of course, we have seen that I use a lot Power Platform, but we can use a lot of Azure components, with, Dynamics 365, especially those one. These ones that are very popular, especially when you are doing some data migration project, but also you will see on the pattern design, you can use it a lot with interfaces. In fact, because it's integration services. So manipulating some data contract, etc., transformation, ETL, and so extract, transform, and load. So it will be, a kind of really powerful component before data management framework. Because you know that data management framework of finance operation is quite powerful now, in this version. But not really the case on AX 2012. But, you have XSLT. Transformation to transform some XML files before integrated in staging tables and after to the target data entities on finance operation. But XSLT has some, it's not the best tool, in fact, to transform data. For me, Azure Data Factory is quite the best one for me. But you will see also that, compared to the Power Platform, of course, these components will be on IT side and not business user, of course. But also you will be able to use, Git, continuous integration, continuous deployment, pull request, automation, in fact, version control, etc. So it's, for me, it's quite, you will have your version control for Dynamics 365 Finance Operation object, classes, forms, data entities, etc. But also a version control for all kind of interfaces that you can build with this kind of components. So again, and you will see, this article this time is not massive because, this video I think will be a good overview for you. I hope, in fact. if you don't know, if you are just an architect or technical developer on finance operation, maybe you don't really know Azure Data Factory. So that's why I made this this article and video. Azure Data Factory is like a really good platform for both kind of data migration and life cycle of the project. You have a lot of connectors, not as many as Logic Apps, because Logic Apps now it's like the core platform. In fact, it's more like 450. Wow. Connectors. And I think Data Factory is quite like just below of 100. Okay. So you don't have as many as Logic Apps connectors, but still you, of course, you have a connector for Dynamics 365. So, and also you will see a lot of connector for database, in fact, because it's, yeah, often to build hybrid extract transform node, especially also for on-premise. Like I've seen some project where you have like Cegid or Oracle or SAP maybe database connector. You have to get data, transform it before loading this data to finance operation. So yeah, you can use Azure Data Factory even with on-premise database. Okay. So as I put it, of course, this famous schema. Of course, you have like Power Platform, but also Logic Apps, a lot of data sources. Not, eventually, not only finance operation, but also IoT, raw data, other application, business application, etc. CSV file, I don't know, but all kind of data you can have. You ingest, of course, this data to the data pipeline of Azure Data Factory. You can prepare your data and transform it and analyze before publishing. Sometimes it's often to data consumption like Power BI, but here, of course, the publish will be finance operation. Eventually to prepare a CSV file before asking data management framework to import it, in fact, you know. With, of course, the standard way of data entities, etc. in finance operation. I put it also, because I like this guy. I don't know if you will see this, my video, but yeah, Adam has done a lot of, I will put also this link of his YouTube channel, but Adam has done a lot of, video on Azure. Especially those kind of component of Azure, Data Factory, Logic Apps, etc. A lot of tutorials. So for me, yeah, on Azure side, if you are part of finance operation only, you really have to go to also Azure for me, because it's inevitable. You will have to go and use Azure component. It's like I said. And like you will show you again today, like Azure Data Lake Storage, it's now maybe for me mandatory on all kind of finance operation project. So if you go to Data Lake Storage, you have just now one component. Maybe you will have after Logic Apps, like with Business Event, and of course Data Factory for batch of large volume of data. Okay, so please, if you are new on Azure, feel free. You have a lot of maybe more than finance operation. You have a lot of tutorials. So I think you can really jump quickly to this component. Azure Data Factory is a code-free ETL, so that's why it's a famous one, because maybe you were aware that, of course, before that, like in AX 2012, we can use, since it was SQL on-premise database, you used in the past SQL services, integration services, SSIS. Azure Data Factory is quite similar, in fact, but it's code-free. I mean code-free. Yeah, it's like Power Platform, in fact, huh? Maybe a little marketing, because, you will use maybe a little code to build very, good transformation, you know? So, of course, but you will see that it's very simple. You have an Azure Data Factory Studio, to build your data pipeline, etc. You have a monitoring, scheduling. You can ingest a lot of data. The data flow side is maybe the most complex part. If you want to join, aggregate, max, SMIN, etc., transform data type, because of course, like in Oracle database, you don't have maybe the same data type as SQL database. Okay. So yeah, maybe the most complex part is on the data flow side. and of course, you can use logic apps. So for me, I've seen some projects where, they soften maybe partners or our customer use, logic apps to build very, like transformation side. But, yeah, logic apps is, you know, is, it's exactly the same as Power Platform or Power Automate, sorry. In fact, when you use Power Automate, you use the logic apps behind the scene. You don't know that, but of course the business user don't know that. He doesn't have to know that, in fact. So it's not a big deal. But for me, logic apps is really on small volume and transactional process, you know. Even the price list, you know, the price list of logic apps is you pay as flow running. If you have a lot of action and connectors on it, of course, also. But yeah, it's really like you want real-time stuff, you know. Like, I don't know, of course, like I've done also on other video or other MVP has done that, huh? On business event, on Dynamics 365 operation, when you build a new, when a business user creates a sales quotation, you want to trigger logic apps to do something else. But on one quotation, okay? Maybe you will transform a little bit this quotation, like few information you need, needed. And after you do, I don't know, send an email, send a notification, I don't know, but you know, it's quite a logic apps, yeah, a logic workflow, and that's it, okay? So for me, transformation on logic apps, you can build very powerful logic app transformation, but for that, you have to use an integration account for B2B communication, and it's quite expensive, this one, so yeah, for me, yeah, logic apps, transformation, yeah, very simple one, okay? And small volume. Don't use logic apps to import a CSV file of 400,000 lines to transform, call a fans operation with the OData API, etc. Okay? No way. So for that, use Data Factory. Because Data Factory, it can take a while. Maybe 1 minute to initialize the flow, the data pipeline before integration, you know? So you can't expect to have real time stuff, on the Data Factory pipeline. Okay. So it's like a batch. I don't know. Every night you want to import those kind of large volume of data. Data Factory is for big data analysis, that big data transformation, large volume of data. And large volume of transformation and more complex transformation. Okay. So be careful because as you know, maybe you have a lot of Azure components now, maybe more than 100. Sometimes if you go to Azure integration services, you have a lot of components and you don't know, but why, when and how I use this tool and not the other one. Okay. That's a famous question every time. So. And maybe, so choose the right tool for your right process. That's my main best practices that I can show you. Of course, as I said, you have the ability to use continuous integration and delivery of Azure Data Factory. That's a massive one. And for me, it's even for logic apps versus Power Automate. Of course, Power Automate now, finally, you can have, on Azure DevOps, a good pipeline release and release pipeline, in fact, to if you have multiple Power Platform environments, you can really deploy automatically, etc., do some testing, but it's quite new, in fact. Whereas Azure Data Factory, even logic apps, used a lot of continuous integration. In fact, for maybe all kind of Azure components, you can really use Azure DevOps as a main tool to build, release and deploy your pipeline, in fact. So in dev, UAT, Q&A and production. So you will use Azure Resource Manager templates. And yeah, it's quite good, because if you have an Azure DevOps for Dynamics 365, your code of Dynamics 365 build pipeline for finance operation. You can have a build pipeline also for all kind of interfaces you have done with this kind of Azure components. Okay. I will put this link of this article, but it's very, 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 very long. So not very digest to read, but if you want to use Azure Data Factory, it's quite, of course, for all kind of components, it's good to know how to build an Azure Data Factory, but of course, it's often good to know where, how I can use after on the DevOps side, you know. So, and you have the same, of course, with Azure Logic Apps, because you can use a template, resource, Azure Template Resource Manager to build and deploy, of course, your Logic Apps. Okay. On my main best practices for Logic Apps, I think I've put it, I don't know. Be careful, Logic Apps, and even in the Data Factory, sorry, but the two of us, these two of components, you have often the ability to use the shared, you know, component with all kind of customer. It will not be dedicated environment for you only. Okay. So by default, like Logic Apps, you like Power Platform, in fact, because Power Platform, you use, a whole shared Azure API management for all kind of connector. And for this, Azure Logic Apps and Data Factory, you often be by default on a shared component. So of course, for development and UAT, it's good. You don't expect to have a dedicated environment just for you. But for production, of course, use a dedicated, in Azure Logic Apps, it's called Azure Integration Environment. You pay more, of course. I think I've put it the price below. Yeah. Integration Services Environment. As you can see, the cost for Logic Apps is not very expensive, in fact. You can see that, but of course, it depends on how many connector you use, even enterprise-wide. It's often enterprise connector, in fact. It's like the premium connector for Automate. And at the end, you have a fully isolated and dedicated environment just for you. And it's better also if you have for Logic Apps, on-premise high-scale application, hybrid connection, hybrid on-premise connection. So you want to use, security purpose, etc. And you can see that €6 per hour, it can be expensive at the end. Huh? But for production, for me, you have to use this kind of thing because, you know that, it's just for you and not shared with everyone. Okay. And for Data Factory, it's exactly the same. Maybe a little more complex, but, you have an Azure integration runtime, but it's a shared one. Okay. And after you have ability to use your own virtual machine to, in fact, run your Data Factory pipeline. Okay. As you can see, you will pay more, in fact, than you have the ability, as you can see, a self-hosted integration runtime. But for that, you can like have a multiple virtual machine in production for Data Factory, handled by you, and you have the ability to change the amount of core, memory, etc., SSD, you can build, I don't know, four virtual machine to have a scale set. And, So of course, like Logic Apps for production, use your own self-hosted integration runtime. Okay. Because you can change what you want to change in production. If you go to Azure Integration Runtime, it's of course cheaper, but you don't have the ability to change something on the virtual machine that will run your Data Factory pipeline. So, okay. Okay, so I think I've put it also a link. I will put also this link, how to deploy Logic Apps. This guy, thanks to him, he make a good article to use, also Visual Studio. So you don't have to use only the portal for building your logic apps. You can use, of course, Visual Studio. And I think it's quite good for developers because they are used to work on Visual Studio. And you can use the deployment side, Azure Group, Resource Group. You can deploy it on the development side. You will see that you have just some JSON file for parameter file, for prod, for test, etc. And you can use on Azure DevOps, of course, build your own pipeline to release your artifact on every kind of environments you want. Okay. So, and you can do some testing purpose on logic apps, you know, a mock data to know if it works, to do some performance testing. So yeah, for me, it's quite more. Yeah, it's for developer, in fact, in Azure. And that's why Portomate is good for business user, but yeah, you will have more possibility to be more on DevOps side, on IT side, if you go to Logic Apps than Portomate. Okay. So as I said, just to finish, and I will do a good demonstration. So of course, it's easy to use. Yeah. Maybe a little marketing, but of course, I don't know, but I think I didn't say that, but of course, on every Azure Data Factory pipeline, you can add an SCCS runtime on the middle of your pipeline. So if you have built built before, like in X 2012, a lot of SCCS package, maybe you don't have to delete it all. You can maybe use them, change a little, I think, of course, but you will not start from zero, okay? Even for CRM side, customer engagement for Dynamics 365, I know that you have Dataflow on Power Platform, but for me, Dataflow, you use Power Query Editor to transform, but Power Query, yeah, it's quite powerful, but it's not Data Factory. Yeah, Data Factory for me is the best tool to transform everything you want. And of course, it's a cost effective side because you pay only when it's running. Okay. So yeah, quite good for that. And, and really you can transform everything you want. And with the data flow, you can, So as you can see, Azure Data Factory can call an on-premise SQL service integration services, but also running this kind of thing on the cloud side, if you want. And yeah, as I said, you have a lot of connector and not only Dynamics, of course, but for me, it's like all kind of component now of Azure. You can, or for platform, you have a lot of connector and not just for Microsoft. Okay. And on Logic Apps documentation, you have a lot of thing to know. So yeah, feel free to go to the documentation. For me, not in French maintenant, in English, sorry. You have a lot of guide, tutorials, as I said, you have also MVP, community members that have done a lot of tutorials. So you can really jump quickly, even if you were just only a Dynamics 365 expert. It's very good to know the basic information, because sometimes, like me, as an architect, you will have to propose the right tool for your Dynamics 365 project. Maybe you will not be the guy that will build this kind of pipeline, but maybe you will have to propose the right tool for them. So that's why it's very important to maybe you will not be the massive expert on Data Factory or Logic Apps, but you know the basic information. So it's very good to have, a curious mind. So to know of kind of components you can use, in fact, on top of your ERP. Because for me, ERP can't be a standalone application, you know, just one ERP, that's it. of course, you have often a lot of interfaces, so that's normal for me and for an ERP system. So, yeah. So, if I go to my data factory, so as you can see on Logicap, okay, so you have a designer, that's quite normal, but you have a designer very similar, as I said, as Power Automate, of course. But of course, since we are on Azure side, it's you have proposed for you maybe more connector by default by Azure, you know. So it's because you will often build Logicap interfaces for all kind of integration, but business integration, B2B integration, you know, and not business user for Automate Flow. Like when a file is added to a FTP server, I want to transform, as I said, a little bit information and maybe call Dynamics 365 to integrate this kind of data. Okay. On Logicap, a good best practices that I can show you, of course, is the log analytics. Okay. So for all kind of component now on Azure, you have the ability to use diagnostic settings. Okay. Here. And you can put every diagnostic information to a log analytics Azure monitoring side. And of course, you can build some metrics and alerts. Okay. That's not the case for Power Automate. So, you know, a good difference for that. Because, you have some, of course, in Power Automate Flow, you have, you can see all previous running side and you can check if it was good or not. But alerting is not maybe a good tool for that. When you have a lot of flow fade, of course, on Power Automate, you receive an email, but yeah. It's not best as of course Logicap. And yeah, you can, so for me, yeah, if you go to Logicap, directly go activate diagnostic settings and Azure monitoring and log analytics and alerts and so on. So okay, monitoring is very important of course on Azure, because if when you will deploy on production, some interfaces will be really important to monitor if it's good or not. And you can, like Power Automate, if you don't see a connector, as I said, you have 450 connector, but you can build your own Azure API management connector, as like Power Platform for Power Automate. So for Logicap, yeah, you can use even if you have an API on-premise API with a Swagger, and you want to be part of an Azure connector on Logicap, you can build your own one, and it will be used, you can use after, of course, on every Logicap you want on your tenant. Okay. So as I said here, I'm not on a dedicated instance, as I said, but of course, if I were on a production side, I will use an integration service account. And, yeah. It's a good thing to know. So if I want to build, you have a Logicap designer, you have the ability to see that, like you can see that on a JSON file on the Visual Studio, because when you build a Logicap on Visual Studio, it makes, of course, you will use, in fact, a JSON file. Of course, you have the designer, the good designer, but at the end, it's a JSON file. Okay. So of course, that's why you can use a Git. Git side, version control, because, you can, do some commit and merging code, etc. And, yeah. But of course, you have the Logicap designer. And as I said, it's exactly the same, as the Power Automate. So I will not show you that. I think now, if you go to my previous video, you have seen that, you have, end-to-end flow design, and yeah, you can rebuild quickly your flow with that. But as I said, really only small transformation and not very large one. Okay. On Azure Data Factory. So I've got an invalid Git configuration. So as I said, first thing to do when you create an Azure Data Factory, of course, is to activate the Git Git integration on an Azure DevOps project. Okay. It's quite a thing to know. And of course, you will have a repository with Git control. And you have, of course, the ability to do tags, pull requests, pushes, branches, etc. So if you are a multiple developer, building your Azure Dev Factory pipeline, you can have local development, local dev Git branches and do a merging branches, after an QA branches, and after, of course, the master one for the production. So that's quite similar on every Git project. But yeah, use Git on Data Factory because it's very important for me to use version control for the Data Factory because like Logicapps, it's of course important to not build quickly a Data Factory pipeline on not being part of the Git version control. Okay. So at the end, you will go to your Azure Data Factory portal dashboard. You have a lot of tutorials on it. Okay. That's good to know. But yeah, Logicapps is quite, very fast to learn. You would see, like for Automate, in fact. But Logicapps, Data Factory, sorry. It's, yeah, maybe a little complex, to know. But, since it's a code-free, data pipeline, yeah, you can really build something for me in 1 month. Yeah, you will be ready. I think you know everything. As I said, the most complex part is the data flow side for transformation. But for a very, very simple data pipeline on Data Factory, yeah, you it's not massive to learn. So as I said, you have some things to know. Sometimes when you build an Azure Data Factory pipeline, you have to copy data. Okay, it's like the extract information, and it's very important to know. But for transformation in data flow, you will have to use a staging SQL Server information. You know, you can't extract data from finance operation. Okay. And transform it in a data flow side before exporting on CSV file. Okay, if you just do a basic transformation and copy and extract. Okay, maybe if you just use the EL of ETL on your data pipeline. Okay, that's good. But if you use ETL transformation on the intermediate side, you have to use an SQL staging table. For me, as a good best practices, of course. You have to use an SQL Azure database, in fact, okay, for all kind of staging information before transformation and after, okay. So because it's very important for the data flow side, when you copy data, you have to copy on something. You know, you can't extract information from this operation, put it nowhere, and after do transformation and do loading extract push your data like a CSV file at the end, okay. So build, create and use an Azure SQL database for that. Also, good best practices on Azure Data Factory, don't call OData API to retrieve get OData API for large volume of data table, okay? So use, as I said often, use data lake storage, okay? So as I said in my previous article on my blog or video, like the previous one, Modern Data Warehouse, in a very few months, weeks, you can use, in fact, Azure Data Feeds services to push tables and data entities on the data lake storage side. And after, if you need to do an interfaces in real time stuff, I forget to mention, but it will be in near real time, this kind of thing. And you can, after that, extract it, this CSV file on your data lake storage. And after, since you have a connector on Data Factory for Data Lake, even the CDM folder, you know the partition side, the hierarchy folders on Data Lake Storage, the model JSON file to have the metadata properties on every kind of column you have on CSV file on your Data Lake Storage. And yeah, so for me, yeah, for Data Factory, of course, if you just have to call a data entity where you just have 100 line, okay, for rows, okay, fine, you can of course use it because you are good to go and it's real time stuff. But yeah, don't use it to retrieve data from Ledger Journal Trans or I don't know, but okay. Because otherwise you will decrease a lot of your performance of your production. So since for me, yeah, data lake storage, it's a bring your own database side now. It's a good replacement. You have, of course, the ability to use again for few months now the entity stores, aggregate measurement also on data lake storage. So yeah, everything on data lake storage. If you need to do a data pipeline to retrieve data, from finance operation in a data factory, use data lake storage. Okay. And if you want a design pattern to the other side, of the flow, if you want to retrieve data from, I don't know, Oracle on-premise database, you want to extract information and loading that in finance operation, of course, you can, use Data Factory, of course, but don't integrate that after, because Data Factory is great for the large volume of data, okay? So for me, Data Factory at the end of the flow, if you want to load data, use, of course, the data management framework, okay? You can, of course, call the batch data API of finance operation after publishing this CSV file on another blob storage. Because I don't know, you have a flow here, you have a copy data. So you extract data from an Oracle database. You do some transformation in it. Okay. Sorry. Maybe I can use that. Oh, so as I said, I will go to the data flow side after for you. So here you can, imagine you are on Oracle database, you extract transformation. So of course you can do parallelism. You can do multiple data sources. It's not a problem, not a big deal. You can do transformation, right? Okay. After you can depose this kind of CSV file on the blob storage and after call an API, the batch data API of finance operation asking data management framework with the data project to run asynchronous way. of course, sometimes on off business hour side, to load your large volume file. Okay. So don't do of course you can do for each here, after transformation for each line, call one line per line, the OData API of finance operation to integrate your data. Don't do that. Of course you can use also an Azure function, okay, on Data Factory to maybe if you want to sometimes on very complex transformation, you will have to use an Azure function to do C#.NET code that you can use, and of course you can also use it of course on your Logic App. So sometimes on every kind of integration services you will use Azure function. Okay. So you can call a webhook or a story procedure. You can use variable, lookup, you can execute SSES package. Okay. You can build a main data pipeline with child data pipeline, but also this kind of thing, you can do it on Logic App. And sometimes this kind of component of Azure can also use it on machine learning, you know, preparation data, machine learning side, before do some prediction. Okay. So that's why, as I said, if you export all kind of data on a data lake storage from finance operation, maybe you can build an Azure Data Factory pipeline to prepare data to be used after on an Azure machine learning pipeline, your prediction stuff. You can debug on real time your flow when you trigger. So you can trigger, of course, your data pipeline of Data Factory on demand ad hoc. But of course, you can also call this kind of flow externally. Okay. So of course, like I said, you have business event on data on the Dynamics 365, you know that, huh? You can use Logic App or Automate Flow and call also HTTPS, you know, HTTPS call. And when you have deployed your Data Factory, you have an HTTPS long URL to be called outside and to launch in real time your Data Factory. Okay? So that's, I say that because you can, in fact, on a business event, call an Azure Data Factory pipeline on finance operation. That's good to know. And when you use a data flow, as I said, it's the massive one component when you will be able to asking your source, of course. You can have multiple data sources because it's important, because sometimes you have to join these multiple data sources, of course. Do some aggregation, do some filtering, sorting, alter row, exit join, etc., conditional splitting. After, when you do that, you do a transformation, you want, and of course, at the end, it will ask you a sync database. So that's why I said you have to use an SQL database staging database. Okay. And that's a good thing because also you can inspect when you do your data pipe, your data flow on your Data Factory pipeline, you can inspect in real time what will be the result, in fact. So you are not blinded, you know, building your whole pipeline and data flow transformation and running to check if it's good or not. Okay. So that's important. And you can see in real time your data preview before and after transformation. Okay. So it's very, for me, a very good thing for that. And as I said, you have to build, of course, data set and data set. Here you can use the famous 90 connector you have right now. And of course, not only Microsoft One, even Amazon. And of course, as I said, the, for me, important, the Azure Data Lake Storage Generation 2. Okay. Even the common data service for Power Platform. And of course, Dynamics 365. Don't know why they have again Dynamics CRM. And for me, the funny thing, Dynamics AX. Wow. Please, Microsoft, rename this thing. It's very funny. And, so it's use Dynamics AX connector for finance operation. Okay. It's not AX 2012. It's finance operation. And when you have this kind of thing, it will ask something to be used, this connector. So this connector is for the OData, OData API. And as you know, you have your link of your URL instance of finance operation / data. You have to create an Azure Active Directory application with, you know, the client ID. So service principal ID, it's the client ID of your application on Azure Active Directory and your token client secret of this application ID. And remember, you have to, after to go to your instance of finance operation on Azure Active Directory application on the system administration module. Okay. To also create this client ID. And of course, test your connection and you are free to go. To use the OData API on the Data Factory. Okay. Of course, you have the monitoring side. You have the manage side. So on manage, it's here when you can use, you know, asking to create your own integration runtime. If you build on production, as I said. So you, as I said, here now I am on auto resolve integration runtime. So I'm on a shared one, but as I said, you can really use your own self-hosted Azure virtual machine to compute and dispatch activities, etc., that have movement. So, of course, on development, it's enough, but of course, on UAT, or if you want to run performance, performance integration, to know if your data flow, how many times you have to, what is the expected time to run all the pipeline. Okay, you have to build your own self-hosted Azure component. Okay, it's here when you can do the Git configuration. You can have a global parameter on all Data Factory, but of course, I don't show it, but You can, of course, when you call your Azure Data Factory, you have the ability to to build a parameter and to pass this kind of parameter on every, if you, as I said, if you build one main Data Factory pipeline before calling in a parallelism all kind of child data flow, you can pass parameter between the two of them. Even when you ask and call your Azure Data Factory externally with your HTTPS URL, you can pass, of course, a parameter. And as I said, like if you were part on a business event, finance operation, to call an HTTPS Data Factory pipeline, you can pass parameter. You know the JSON schema you have on business event on finance operation. You can pass it through as a Data Factory. It's good also as a good best practices. If you run a lot of a lot of Data Factory pipeline, you can use as a template and reuse something, not to restart from zero every time. Okay. So I think so it was really a quick overview. I can't of course do a tutorial in a few minutes or 1 hour to explain everything on Data Factory, because it's, yeah, as I said, it's more complex to teach, learn and know everything. But for me, yeah, you will see, as you can see, it's not very complex to know, especially if you don't use a lot data flow. If it's just to extract data and do very basic transformation, but it's a large volume, as I said, large volume of data, and you want to export it to a CSV file, that's good to know. Okay. Okay. I think I've done, so I hope you all like this kind of quick overview of integration services of Azure, and yeah. See you next time for event and so on. So yeah, see you, and bye bye, take care, bye bye.